हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू आईटीएलएस एकेडमी। इन दिस लेक्चर टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस माउस एम्ब्रियोनिक स्टेम सेल्स। सो वी आर स्टार्टिंग अवर टॉपिक विद माउस एम्ब्रियोनिक स्टेम सेल कल्चर्स। वी आर गोइंग टू सी how we can culture these stem cells in outside the body, that is in vitro. The very first point is the techniques for culturing mouse embryonic stem cells from the inner cell mass of the pre-implantation blastocyst were first reported 20 years ago. Additionally, studies of embryonal carcinoma cells from mice and humans have helped establish parameters for growing and assessing embryonic stem cells. Coming to the next point, in mice, the efficiency of generating embryonic stem cells is influenced by the genetic strain of laboratory mice and individual factors that affect pregnant females. These influence on the efficiency with which embryonic stem cells can be cultured from mouse blastocyst is the pregnancy status of the female. Pregnant mice that are in diapause tend to yield embryonic stem cells with greater success. Our next point is generating cultures of mouse or human embryonic stem cells that remain in a proliferating undifferentiated state in a multi-step process that typically includes the following. These are: first, the inner cell mass of a pre-implantation blastocyst is removed from the trophoectoderm. Trophoectoderm is the outer layer of the blastocyst. If this is our blastocyst, this will contain some cells, mass of cells on one side and an outer covering that is known as trophoectoderm. So trophoectoderm is the layer that surrounds it, that surrounds blastocyst. Second one, after several days to a week, proliferating colonies of cells are removed and dispersed into new culture dishes, each of which also contains MEF feeder layer. In the third major step required to generate embryonic stem cell lines, the individual non-differentiating colonies are dissociated and replated into new dishes, a step known as passage. This replating process establishes a line of embryonic stem cells. The line of cells is clonal if a single embryonic stem cell generate it. If this is our embryonic stem cell, if it generates any cell line, so if it is, this is single embryonic cell and this is generating a whole cell line, so this will be known as clonal. Here in this diagram, you can see the origins of mouse pluripotent stem cells is shown. The mouse pluripotent stem cells are embryonic stem cells, embryonic germ cells, and embryonic carcinoma cells. We will see each and every cell's origin. First one is our embryonic stem cells, next is embryonic germ cells, and third one is embryonic carcinoma cells. So let us see one by one how these are originated. First one is embryonic stem cell. These are originated from the blastocyst. Blastocyst contains outer layer that is known as trophoderm, trophoblast layer, and this is a mass of cell that is known as inner cell mass. The cells of the inner cell mass are cultured in nutrient media outside the body, that is in vitro medium. After the culture process, transfer of stem cells to mouse blastocyst. You can see this is mouse blastocyst and these cultured cells are transferred in it. And the result, you can see there is formation of normal blastocyst. For the test of origin of embryonic germ cells, you can see here this is the embryo of day 10.5, that is 10 and half. E10.5 mouse embryo is taken. These are primordial germ cells. So the cells from this primordial germ line is taken and cultured in vitro. The result again is same, that is formation of a normal blastocyst has occurred. In the third step, that was embryonic carcinoma cells, the cells are taken from the testicular teratocarcinoma. This is the site from where the cells of carcinoma are taken. These cells are again cultured in nutrient media in vitro. And further, these cells are transferred in the mouse blastocyst. You can see here, this is mouse blastocyst and these are transferred cell. In result, they formed a normal blastocyst. So this was all about origins of mouse pluripotent stem cells. Pluripotent, as these all cells can give rise to multiple kind of cells, that's why these are known as pluripotent stem cells. Maintaining mouse embryonic stem cells in their undifferentiated state. The first point that we are going to see is a leukemia inhibitory factor and STAT3 activation. First point, mouse embryonic stem cells can be maintained in a proliferative undifferentiated state in vitro, that is outside the body, by growing them on feeder layers of MEF cells, that is mouse embryonic stem cells on feeder layer of MEF cells. An alternative to culture on feeder layers is the addition of leukemia inhibitory factors, in short it is known as LIF, to the growth medium. Leukemia inhibitory factor is produced by feeder cells and in their absence allows mouse embryonic stem cells in vitro to continue proliferating without differentiating. Next point, leukemia inhibitory factors exert its effect by binding to a two-part receptor complex that consists of the leukemia inhibitory factor receptor and the GP130 receptor. The binding of leukemia inhibitory factor triggers the activation of the latent transcription factor, that is STAT3. This is a necessary event in vitro for the continued proliferation of mouse embryonic stem cells. In vivo signaling through the GP130 receptor is not necessary for normal, or we can say for early embryonic development, but is required to maintain the epiblast during the diapause state. If we talk about the process of gastrulation that is happening in embryo, so after gastrulation, this leukemia inhibitory factor signaling and STAT3 activation promote the differentiation of specific cell lineages such as the myeloid cells of the hematopoietic system or the astrocyte precursor cells in the central nervous system. Here the signaling pathway is shown in this diagram. You can see this is mouse and this is blastocyst that is separated from this mouse. From the mouse, the cells from the inner cell mass that are embryonic stem cells are taken and are cultured in a medium. Here you can see signaling pathway. This is leukemia inhibitory factor receptor and this is GP130 receptor. When the ligand binds to this receptor, there is dimerization of this receptor. This is JAK-STAT signaling pathway. These are JAK domain. These have kinase activity and have the ability to phosphorylate another receptor. On the other hand, there is a GAP protein that is linked with SHP2 domain. These are SHP domain is a pathway of signal transduction. So whenever there is a dimerization of this JAK receptor, there is a recruitment of a transcription factor that is known as STAT3. After activation, there is STAT activation. This activated STAT3 also forms dimer. You can see here, these are two STAT3. This is the dimer of STAT. This STAT have the ability to go into the nucleus, and this STAT can activate many transcription factors, and also this have the ability to give these stem cells the property of self-renewal. Coming to the next signaling pathway that is happening here, this is ERK pathway. After the activation of ERK, this is ERK1/2, you can see here, this ERK blocks the property of self-renewal. This is whole, this pathway is the signal transduction pathway. For a more clear picture of this pathway, I have taken two points. Let us see what are these points. The self-renewal of mouse embryonic stem cells also appears to be influenced by SHP2 and ERK activity. You can see here, SHP2 and GAP after binding, these can activate ERK, and this ERK is responsible for the inhibition of self-renewal. So these two points, that is SHP2 and ERK activity, these are the steps that can help in blocking of self-renewal pathway. Next point given here is, both ERK and SHP2 are components of a signal transduction pathways that counteract the proliferative effects of STAT3 activation. Counteract means, if STAT3 is activating the process of self-renewal, so the ERK3 inhibiting the process of self-renewal. From this experiment, it was clear that if ERK and SHP2 are active, they inhibit embryonic stem cell self-renewal. So mouse embryonic cells in vitro express high amounts of a modified version of an adapter protein that is GAB1. This is the adapter protein. Let me write here for the better understanding. This is adapter protein. This GAB is also known as GAB1. The unusual form of GAB1 that occurs in embryonic stem cells may suppress interactions of specific receptors to the RAS ERK signaling pathway. Expression of OCT4 in undifferentiated pluripotent cells. First point, OCT4 is present in the mouse zygote and is required throughout blastocyst development to establish and maintain the pluripotency of the inner cell mass and epiblast. Mouse embryonic stem cells in vitro can replicate indefinitely and can produce 109, that is 109 to 1010, that is 1 to 10 billion cells without differentiating. Next point, as is the case with inner cell mass and epiblast cells in vivo, OCT4 expression in vitro is required to maintain the pluripotent undifferentiated state of embryonic stem cells. If OCT4 expression is inhibited in cultured mouse embryonic stem cells, the cells generate trophoectoderm. The level of OCT4 expression dictates a significant aspect of the developmental program of mouse embryonic stem cells and making the protein a candidate master regulator of embryonic stem cell pluripotency. The cell cycle of mouse embryonic stem cells, that is, its role in preventing differentiation. First point, like the cells of the epiblast in the pre-implantation mouse embryo, mouse embryonic stem cells in vitro have an unusual cell cycle. Specifically, the G1 checkpoint does not appear to operate in proliferating epiblast and embryonic stem cells. Next point is, if embryonic stem cells begin to differentiate by forming embryoid bodies, cyclin D expression increases, the G1 phase of the cell cycle becomes longer and the rate of cell division slows. This can occur if leukemia inhibitory factor or feeder layers are withdrawn from mouse embryonic stem cell cultures, then cell division continues for only a few days as the process of differentiation begins. Next point is, perhaps constant cell proliferation somehow inhibits cell differentiation. Markers of undifferentiated embryonic stem cells. First point, embryonic stem cells and EC cells, as well as cells of the inner cell mass of mouse blastocyst express a panel of surface markers that are used to characterize undifferentiated pluripotent embryonic cells. The markers also distinguish mouse embryonic cells and EC cells from human ES and EC cells. Next point, human embryonic germ cells, which are derived from primordial germ cells, express all three markers, that is SSEA1, SSEA3 and SSEA4. The biological significance of the expression patterns of these surface antigens is unclear, but SSEA1 expression may be related to the growth characteristics of the cells in vitro. Other markers used to identify embryonic stem cells are the surface antigens TRA160, TRA181, and the enzyme alkaline phosphatase. All occurs in human embryonic cells as they do in their mouse counterparts. Genomic imprinting in embryonic stem cells. First point, in genomic imprinting, DNA methylation marks certain genes depending on whether they are inherited from the mother or the father. The marked genes are turned on or off in a non-random pattern that is determined by parental origin. Next point, when embryonic development occurs in vitro or when embryonic stem cells are grown in tissue culture, normal patterns of genomic imprinting may be disturbed. The imprinting pattern of human embryonic stem cells in vitro has not yet been determined. Next point, how or whether the use of fetal calf serum for culturing mouse or human embryonic stem cells affects genomic imprinting and the behavior of embryonic stem cells in vitro is not known. Thank you very much everyone for connecting with ITLS Academy. Follow ITLS Academy on various social media platforms. Thank you very much everyone for watching this session. Thank you very much.